In the hot summer of 1943, a conspicuous circus tent was erected within Lockheed's Burbank compound. Downwind from a pungent plastics factory, the tent was strategically placed to deter prying eyes. Lockheed Chief Engineer Kelly Johnson covertly gathered an elite cadre inside this makeshift workspace. The handpicked team received their orders: commit to relentless hours crafting a new aircraft prototype, entirely under Johnson's directive, facing seemingly insurmountable deadlines. While the specifics remained undisclosed, the urgency was palpable, as German jet fighters threatened to eclipse all aerial combatants in the European theater. Rising to the occasion, this dedicated team embarked on a mission to birth America's first operational jet fighter, the P-80 Shooting Star. In the pantheon of World War II aviation, German high-tech marvels like the Henkel HE-162 Volksjäger, Messerschmitt ME-262, and the Henkel HE-163 Comet often soar into the spotlight. Their sleek designs and groundbreaking technology epitomize the Third Reich's desperate bid for aerial dominance. But they were not alone in the race to control the skies with jet power. The British were also pioneers in jet technology. The first turbojet engine emerged not from a secretive lab in Berlin, but from the mind of a Royal Air Force officer named Frank Whittle. As early as 1930, Whittle had conceptualized this revolutionary propulsion method. His vision took flight with the Gloster E-2839, the Allies' first foray into jet aviation, which reached the sky in 1941. Across the Atlantic, American engineers, inspired by Whittle's breakthrough, produced the Bell P-59 Era Comet. This American debut in the jet fighter world took its maiden flight in October 1942. But unlike its German counterparts, the P-59 struggled to find its niche. 66 of these aircraft came to life, but their hearts lacked the power and precision needed for wartime combat. Their performance was such that they couldn't outpace the latest piston-driven fighters of the era. Even the British RAF, after evaluating the P-59, deemed it inferior to their own Gloster Meteor. But this didn't spell the end of American jet ambitions. While German jet fighters like the ME-262 often overshadow their counterparts in history books, aircraft like the P-80 would soon stake their claim, playing a pivotal role in World War II, and importantly, setting the trajectory for the future of jet aviation. Spring 1943 marked a significant turn in the Allies' approach to jet aviation. The discovery of the ME-262, Germany's jet fighter, stirred a sense of urgency within the Allied ranks. The US, realizing that time was of the essence, decided not to reinvent the wheel. Instead, they sought to capitalize on existing British jet technology. The chosen power plant was the Halford H-1B Goblin engine. While the initial American foray into jet aviation with the P-59 showed promise, it was clear that greater strides needed to be taken to match the prowess of the German ME-262. And so, that June, a new chapter in aviation history began. Lockheed had embarked on the jet journey as early as 1939 with their L-133. Boasting futuristic design elements like canard forewings and a blended wing body, the L-133 was cutting edge. Yet, uncertain of the L-133's feasibility, the Army Air Force favored the less advanced Bell P-59 Era Comet. When the P-59 displayed only marginal performance improvements over piston-engine fighters, the baton was passed to Lockheed to refine and reimagine the design. Their challenge was to design a fighter that would be the US's answer to the ME-262, harnessing the power of the de Havilland-built Halford H-1B turbojet engine, developed in a bid to offset the German aerial threat. Lockheed's chief engineer, Kelly Johnson, took up this task with fervor. Even before the Goblin engine was available from across the pond, Johnson marshaled a team of the brightest minds. Under a cloak of secrecy and fueled by a sense of duty and patriotism, they toiled for six grueling 10-hour days every week. The mission was crystal clear: deliver a prototype for the US Army Air Force, and do so within a tight 150-day timeframe. The stakes were nothing short of reshaping the course of the war. In a whirlwind of innovation and ambition, the XP-80 was conceived and constructed in a staggering 143 days, beating the deadline by a week. This was no rudimentary model. It was a combat-ready prototype, armed and potent. This clandestine project took root in a covert makeshift facility, the genesis of what would become the legendary Lockheed Skunk Works. By early 1944, Skunkworks had given birth to its magnum opus, the XP-80 Lulu Bell. Architecturally, the XP-80 was conventional, an all-metal aircraft bearing a slim low wing and a tricycle landing gear. Reflecting the design practices of its time, the XP-80 donned straight wings, mirroring its propeller-driven predecessors. However, it's worth noting that the P-80 Shooting Star broke away from conventional jet designs of the time. Unlike other jet fighters, its engine wasn't housed under the wings or as external pods. Instead, it nestled right within the aircraft's fuselage. The reasoning was simple. Earlier engines were less potent, necessitating duplicates. But as British jet technology evolved, a single fuselage-mounted engine became a more efficient solution, setting a standard that many future fighter aircraft would adopt. Internally, it could carry between 200 to 285 gallons of fuel, and its nose bristled with six 50-caliber machine guns. Its cockpit, featuring an aft sliding canopy, offered pilots an unhindered view. With the British H-1B engine at its heart, on January 8th, Lulu Bell soared, touching speeds over 500 miles per hour at altitudes above 20,000 feet, setting a benchmark for U.S. Army Air Force turbojets. Witnessing this aerodynamic marvel, a proud Kelly Johnson declared the flight a phenomenal success, emphasizing its potential to rival years of German jet advancements and marking the dawn of more prototypes in the P-80 lineage. In the thick of World War II, as the German ME-262 took to the skies, the USAAF was impatient to introduce its own cutting-edge technology, the P-80 Shooting Star, to the aerial theater. Hoping that the Shooting Star might counter the German jet menace, a select unit of four YP-80As was rapidly dispatched to European soils. While two were sent to the UK as training modules, the remaining duo was destined for Italy, to be assimilated within the first fighter group stationed at Lassina Airfield. However, Italy presented an intricate scenario. The Luftwaffe, not to be outdone, was already deploying its jet-powered avatar in the Italian theater. The Arado AR-234B Blitz, a reconnaissance jet, frequently skimmed over Allied defenses, its speed rendering it untouchable by traditional Allied aircraft. As such, the YP-80A was deployed with high expectations. In an official capacity, one of these advanced aircraft, now under the banner of the 94th Fighter Squadron, took to the Italian skies for two operational sorties. The specifics of these flights are shrouded in mystery and are catalogued as non-combat. Despite ambitions for a more pivotal role in turning the tide of the war, unforeseen production lags hampered the P-80's anticipated combat debut. The aircraft, though bursting with potential, saw its combat ambitions in World War II curtailed by these unforeseen delays. Still, the type was the only American jet fighter to see service during the war. With a robust production run, eventually 1,715 Shooting Stars graced the skies. As production surged, the British engine that had powered the initial prototypes was replaced. The P-80 was now powered by the Allison J-33A-35, an engine nestled internally, boasting a remarkable 4,600 pounds of dry thrust. This enhancement propelled the Shooting Star to speeds approaching Mach 0.76 and granted it an operational range of 825 miles. Beyond its engineering prowess, the P-80 was a veritable arsenal. Its nose housed six 50 AN-M3 Browning machine guns, while its wings were equipped with hardpoints and specialized rails. These allowed the aircraft to be armed with eight high-velocity aerial rockets and two hefty 1,000-pound bombs. However, the compact design of the P-80 posed limitations on further weapon augmentation. While the USAAF envisaged vast squadrons of the Shooting Star, the end of the European conflict meant only two reached Italy, neither seeing combat. Nevertheless, the war's end didn't spell the aircraft's demise. Production persisted, albeit at a slower pace. Of the produced fleet, Lockheed constructed 917 of the F-80A and B models. One such aircraft was modified with a singular aim, to shatter the world speed record. And on June 19, 1947, it achieved just that, clocking a staggering 624 miles per hour. These record-setting modifications influenced the design of the 798 F-80Cs churned out between 1948 and 1949. Concurrently, Lockheed introduced the F-94 Starfire, a two-seater variant, now equipped with radar, making it a powerful all-weather combatant. but it would take a while until it saw combat for the first time. In the aftermath of World War II, the P-80 Shooting Star's legacy was far from over. It found renewed purpose in the Korean War, evolving into the fighter-bomber variant known as the F-80. Simultaneously, select units of the P-80A transitioned to naval duty, undergoing modifications for deployment aboard the USS Franklin D. Roosevelt. When conflict ignited in Korea, F-80s swooped into the fray, bolstering South Korean defenses. It was during one such sortie, on November 10, 1950, when an F-80C, helmed by Lieutenant Russell Brown, vanquished a Russian MiG-15 fighter in the skies above Korea, clinching the first American jet-on-jet takedown against a MiG-15. These aircraft were responsible for an estimated 75% of enemy losses in the war's early months, though at the cost of 368 F-80s, primarily to ground fire. The F-80, while originally conceived as a high-altitude interceptor, displayed its versatility in Korea. It undertook roles from photo reconnaissance to day fighting and bombing runs. It confronted the North Korean MiG-15s, Ilyushin IL-10s, and Yakovlev YAK-9s with mostly positive results. Despite its achievements, the F-80, in the larger context of the war, was eclipsed by the superior performance of the MiG-15. Its design, rooted in World War II-era blueprints, left the F-80 lagging in speed, which precipitated the rise of the swifter North American F-86 Sabre in Korea. Given the F-80's challenging flight dynamics compared to traditional piston-engine planes, there was a pressing need for adequate pilot training. The solution manifested in the form of the T-33A two-seat trainer, a redesign that stayed in production until August 1959. The XP-80's journey was not without sacrifice. The testing phase of this pioneering aircraft took the lives of experienced pilots, including World War II's top-scoring USAAF ace, Major Richard Bong. Bong experienced a fatal mishap on August 6, 1945. Shortly after his P-80 Shooting Star's takeoff, a malfunction with its primary fuel pump occurred. Bong's failure to engage the auxiliary pump, coupled with a low-altitude ejection attempt, sadly cost him his life. These tragedies underscored the experimental nature of early jet technology, even as they demonstrated the unwavering commitment to advancement. Post-World War II assessments pitched the P-80 against the ME-262, revealing the superior speed, acceleration, and climb performance of the German jet. Yet, this comparison doesn't diminish the P-80's significance. The P-80's legacy culminated with the T-33 trainer model. But during the pioneering years of jet aviation, the T-33 trainer presented an unforeseen challenge that proved fatal. Just behind the cockpit, a filler cap for the fuselage fuel tank was hidden beneath a Zeus-fastened cover plate. Regrettably, a lack of vigilance in securing this cap had tragic consequences. After takeoff, when the aircraft reached around 120 knots, the airflow would create a suction over the fuel cap. If improperly secured, jet fuel would be drawn out into a plenum chamber, which aided the engine in its intake of extra air until the aircraft achieved about 200 knots. The subsequent ignition of this volatile mix would lead the plane to catastrophically explode. The solution emerged in the form of twin fins beneath the cover, ensuring it could only be locked if the cap was correctly in place. This precautionary tale became a staple for pilots, who thereafter diligently inspected the cover. The P-80 Shooting Star's influence on jet aviation cannot be understated. Though its wartime service during World War II was limited, its technological contributions were profound. Acting as a stepping stone for future jets, such as the renowned F-86 Sabre and MiG-15, the P-80 heralded a new era. Over its production span, over 1,700 units were manufactured, evolving into the globally recognized T-33 trainer, with a remarkable 6,557 units built by 1959.